everybody, come on, everybody. I'm stuck to the dance floor with the whole team. With the whole team. Let me see you wild. I'm stuck to the dance floor with the whole team. With the whole team. Let me see you shake. Give me your for giving you the whole shit. I'ma give you the whole shit.
Let me see you wild.
I'm stuck to the dance floor with the whole team. With the whole team.
Can you make it break?
Tom, you're on.
Hi, everyone. I'd like to welcome you, CARA members and friends, to our session on emergency preparedness, getting ready for the summer. I'd also like to thank our education committee for putting this together and our staff who does such a good job at all of this. And first I wanna introduce Jody Reed, our executive director, who will talk about why we're doing this, review the agenda and the logistics for questions and answers. Jody.
Hi everybody. Welcome once again to one of CARA's fabulous Friday forums. This one is on emergency preparedness and getting ready for the summer. And given that summer just started this week, although I think many of us have been feeling like we're in summer for a while, it seemed really appropriate for us to do this special emergency preparedness event. So just quickly, part of the reason why we decided to do this, even though we offer some trainings on emergency preparedness through our Empowered Elder workshop, is that we felt like, given the challenges that our state has been facing for many years, and especially the last couple of years with high heat incidences, power outages as a result of the heat, wildfires, and all of the challenges around dealing with those, we felt like we really needed to get a jump on this year, given that it's already been really hot. Some of us have already been subjected to very high heat incidences. Some of us have faced some initial power outages because of it, and fires have started. And so we're going to spend some time getting perspectives both from the professional firefighters on what they see coming this summer and how they're preparing, some tips for you on how you can prepare, and then some advocacy opportunities to make sure that our cities, counties, and state are doing everything possible to help prepare us and prevent disasters from happening in the first place, but also making sure that we have places to go and responses that are necessary for us to all stay safe. So we were going to, after each of the three speakers that Tom will be introducing in a second, we're going to have some time for questions and answers. So when we get to that, you can raise your hand. We'll go over the logistics of raising your hand again, but basically, if you're in the chat, you go down to if you're in Zoom, you go down to the reactions, and there is a little icon to raise your hand. If you're on the phone and you want to ask a question, you press *9. And someone from CARA will call on you. We'll do as many as we can during the time that we have. And if you want to make a comment or a question and put it in the chat, we'll try to respond to those as well. This was being recorded. So if you want to review it again or share it with other people who are unable to come today, it will be on our CARA website. so that you can review both the materials that are presented as well as the recording of today's presentation. So without further ado, back to you, Tom.
Okay, thanks, Jody. So Mike's going to talk to us about what we can expect this summer. Mike is the Secretary Treasurer of the California Professional Firefighters, and want to thank him because they are our newest sustaining member of CARA. The California Professional Firefighters represent over 30,000 firefighters in the state of California. It's the largest statewide organization dedicated exclusively to serving the needs of a career firefighters, and to the State Council of the International Association of Firefighters. Mike's going to give us the firefighters' perspective and what we should be preparing for this summer as we face high heat, possible power outages, and wildfires, all in the midst of a severe drought, which we are in again. Mike has brought with him another firefighter, Bob Monson, who has had a lot of personal experience here, and I'm going to let Mike introduce him. Mike, go for it.
Good morning. Again, Mike Lopez, and I'm retired CAL FIRE Battalion Chief. I did 28 years with CAL FIRE all in the Butte unit, and I have with me is Bob Monson, and I'll let you, Bob, introduce yourself.
I'm Bob Monson, and I was a retired chief of CAL FIRE. I was also a Type 1 incident commander for the major fires or incidents.
And it's very appropriate today. Bob and I are at Eagle Lake in Lassen County with a bunch of retirees from CAL FIRE, and they do an annual get-together, and we just happen to be here. So I thought it was very appropriate to do this during this time as we are in the forest, as you can see. Moving forward, as you all have experienced, we're in absolutely a drought situation. And you know, we had a drought situation about 10 years ago that lasted a hard 5 or 6 years. And during that time frame, you know, our acreages and our fire starts, you know, doubled and tripled. Our largest fires, as you all know, have happened in the last, you know, couple of years. And, you know, talking with a lot of the retirees here at our camp, we would have literally have a career fire over 30 years, probably 2 or 3 times in your career, you would have a career fire. Unfortunately, the current firefighters that are all across the state of California, they're having those fires in a single year. So to look back, you know, just, you know, 10 or 15 years ago to where we are now, it is, as we all are experiencing in California, it's definitely extraordinary. And this, unfortunately, in a lot of our views, is going to be the future of the state of California. And I want to talk a little bit about the lack of rain and what's that mean for the firefighters. The firefighters in the state of California, and this is not just the state firefighters, the local firefighters, it's federal fire, it's everybody in the state of California, a firefighter from Los Angeles City to a firefighter in Alturas. They are all prepared for a wildland fire season. And one of the ways they prepare is they start measuring, CAL FIRE specifically start, and the U.S. Forest Service, they start measuring something called fuel moistures. And fuel moistures is how much moisture is in fuel or brush or timber. And what they do is they measure that, and they start measuring that way early in the year, specifically, let's say January, when we have constant, what we call wetting rain, when there's a constant rain and the fuel moistures start to, they really absorb all that, and they will be absorbed all the way through the year, through that wetting period. But what happens is during a drought year, like we're doing right where we're in now, the drying season starts to happen a lot earlier. And so when you have that continuous wetting rain not happening, then the fuel moisture start to dry out sooner. And what does that mean? That means that the fire season now is longer. It means the fire season is earlier, more dangerous. And the fuel moistures are now, they're usually, when we have, we're in the end of June, these fuel moistures historically don't show up until late August, right around that time. But they're already into their, almost probably their critical stages within the state of California. Different areas that happen sooner than later, Southern California, the fuel moistures dry out a lot faster than they do in Northern California. But right now, I'll tell you, and you can relate to this, I was fishing at the opening season of trout season in late April this year, and we were wearing shorts and t-shirts in late April at 5,000 feet. We were collecting wood for fires, and it was readily ready to burn. And so, and you can see that if you go on the CAL FIRE's website, you go on local websites in your local area, California Office of Emergency Services, OES, and you look at the fire starts, the statistical information, and you can do the research yourself and go back and look at all that. You can see that the fires are already starting. The fire starts are starting, the acreages are greater, and everything is really moving into a very dangerous area throughout the state. One of the things that I want you to be, and people always ask me, and you know, our colleagues is, you know, where does, you know, what's the most dangerous part of the state of California? Well, I can honestly say right now, you know, there, if you don't want to be totally affected with a wildland fire, then you probably want to move into the inner core of the city of San Francisco. And that would probably be just about it. But if you look at what happened in the last couple of years in Santa Barbara, happens in Los Angeles City, Malibu, Sonoma County, look at Napa County, all those areas, they are actively been having major fires. And so if people don't think it can happen to you, please take this very seriously wherever you live in the state of California, and look for your conditions and work with your local fire agencies and your local partners. And of course, again, those state resources that and federal resources. So one of the things that that we do in the state of California is that we prepare for our fire season year round. And how we do that is we have training sessions. Right now, you probably look around and you can in your local jurisdiction and all the local fire departments, whether you're a small fire department in Sonora or the city of San Francisco or Los Angeles or where we're up here in Susanville, everyone is preparing for fire season and they've already been doing this for probably a couple of months. And so state of California is something called Master Mutual Aid. Master Mutual Aid is a system that will be able to move resources up and down the state of California on a moment's notice. This system is probably one of the best systems in the whole world to move resources from one end of the state to the other. We have something called North and South Zones that they look at all the fuel moistures, the drawdown of resources, and where the fire activity is, and they will move resources. They will do some pre-positioning, where if we know we're in, say, Napa again, and we know there's gonna be a north wind event, they will bring in, you know, upwards of 30 or 40 fire engines, and they will stage them in and around that surrounding area in case there is a major fire that breaks out. So those are things that we've been really enhancing with the state of California, with California professional firefighters, Cal Chiefs, again, Cal Fire, OES, all those working partners are working together to make sure that when the big fire starts and we move our machine, our equipment seamlessly across the state. And so that is something that is, again, I think very valuable for the citizens of California is how well we are prepared. One of the things I really, and Bob and I talked about this earlier, was complacency. And that is, and I will tell you, I live in Chico. I spent my time in Butte County, and I was a fire captain at the Jarbo Gap, Concow, Polga area where the campfire started. And when that fire started, I will tell you, on that day, it was 100% it was the perfect storm. The wind was coming down the canyon. The humidities were all time low. The wind speed was extremely fast and the fire started. And unfortunately, the end result was the destruction of the town of Paradise. We have people up here that we're dealing with today that we're camping with that lived through that, that lost their homes, retirees that lost their homes, everything, the citizens of, and it was very, very destructive, as we all know. So, and I'll tell you just one little instance where I know I had retirees tell me that when they received a phone call from a family member that there is a fire starting east of Paradise. And remember, this is where you can become complacent, is if you're in a fire prone area and you hear of a fire and someone calls you, or there is a warning, please take that serious. Because I had personal friends tell me that their parents, when they heard about the warning or the evacuation notice was given, they jumped in the shower, got ready. They were very, I'll say, they didn't take it as serious because they had been through the drill numerous times. And when they walked outside, the fire was already there. And so I know there's going to be another speaker today that's going to speak on preparedness, but I cannot help but really make sure you know in your geographic area where you live, the fire conditions. And right now in the state of California, I would consider every place in the state of California that they're, the fire conditions are ready to go. So if you're not prepared, you really need to get going on it right now. And I just wanted to wrap up by saying I really appreciate, if there's any questions, I know Jody will get those two to us right now. And if there's questions in the queue, both Bob and I, again, Bob is extremely experienced in firefighting. He was, again, a type one incident commander for CAL FIRE, managed numerous fires, major disasters around the state. And if there's any questions, we'll be more than happy to answer them at this time.
Okay. Susan, you want to take questions? If you have a question, raise your hand by checking the raise hand or press *9.
Okay, we have someone up. Jeff, you're up. If you could unmute yourself. Thank you.
Hi, this is Jeff, and appreciating the last 2 years of planning and the pre-positioning. But how is fire now being used to combat wildfires? I understand that's a new proposal that's in its infancy about being using fires to and prescribed burns to fight and prepare for wildfires.
Prescribed fire, I retired after 38 years, and probably for the last 30 years, we've been using, when possible, prescribed fire to prepare and eliminate some of the forest fuels. That is a, I guess for lack of a better term, a highly political issue between air pollution, people all summer long smell smoke, and then all of a sudden in the wintertime, when we can do the prescribed fire burning, we're gonna put up smoke again, and they don't want us to do that. People are starting to realize that it is an excellent tool, but it's not anything new. We have been doing it for years. We've been practicing on the Mendocino National Forest in an area called Grindstone for the last 40 years that I know of. So, and that's where we do a lot of our training.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, saw an excellent documentary about with the campfires, about how that's being more pointed out and used and getting the information out. Because you say it's been in practice, but we need to get a better education understanding about it.
Absolutely. It is, like, as Bob said, it's become very politicized, but it is absolutely a fire tool that we can do much more. And remember that, you know, resources around the state of California, you know, we're playing catch up. I know specifically for the state of California, CAL FIRE, until Gavin Newsom was governor, we had lost 31 engine companies just in the state, not to mention all the local government resources, which has lost numerous engine companies because of budgetary cuts. And so I think that, you know, it's a little slow to react. And again, I don't want to get into the political side of stuff because everyone has their opinion, but we definitely need more resources. We need more fire prevention, more.
One thing.
And here's Bob. Say one more thing.
Another thing that got added into that is within all CAL FIRE units now, we have fuels crews that have been added to the whole populace of the firefighters. They added numerous amounts of equipment. One of the things we run into is, as we're cutting these big fire breaks around the towns and the cities, is you run into a citizen that to be honest with you, doesn't want their brush cut. So that's another part of the thing, is that if you can help us on that side and get those areas opened up where we can prepare these communities, we're a lot better off.
Okay.
Any more questions?
Tom, at this point, I don't see any other hands raised. If you're on the telephone, you can
actually,
press
there is one more question. There is one more question.
Oh, there
Judy,
is one.
Judy Rice. You have to unmute, Judy.
It takes me a while. I put a little bit in the chat I live in Hemet. We have Hemet Ryan Airport. It's a CAL FIRE base. It sounds like I heard through the grapevine that the Board of Supervisors wants to put in FedEx planes in. I have a feeling that that's going to compromise CAL FIRE and all our search and rescue operations and all of that, you know, and CHP, you know, CPA and our air ambulance for that matter. And I just want input back into, I mean, after all, we have Diamond Lake. I mean, it's ideal to be able to help you guys out.
Bob will give you his commentary on that.
Just a little bit. I'm not familiar with the FedEx issue at Hemet Ryan, but almost every one of our air bases statewide, Chico, Fresno, Ronerville, all of them have another function. Specifically in Fresno, they're flying military aircraft. When CAL FIRE starts to launch, they take priority. And that's been the contract with the airport.
Okay. Well, Mike and Bob, thanks so much for educating us about this. And we really appreciate your work. I appreciate it even more. Today, my wife, who actually used to work for the East Bay Park District and fought fires, I remember her coming home once totally covered with poison oak from fighting a fire. So it's hard work. And I really appreciate everything you guys do. This morning she got a Jarvis mailing, Prop 13 mailing. So we're working on that stuff. Don't worry. Thank you. We're working against it and want more funding for you guys. All right. Our next speaker is Marie Jobling. From the Community Living Campaign. Maria is co-director of that campaign. And that campaign is one of CARA's community affiliates based in San Francisco. And we partner with them on many projects, including our Empowered Elder Workshops. Community Living Campaign was founded in 2007 as a small group of activists who had worked for decades to make San Francisco a better place for seniors and people with disabilities. These leaders sought to redefine how people think about long-term care. Thanks to their vision, they're charting a new path for what it means to age in place in California. Marie is going to provide us some tips on how to prepare ourselves in case of an emergency, any emergency, not just fires. You have a flyer attached to the email that you got about this session that you can print out for yourself, and that has these tips in it. It's also on the CARA website. So Marie, go ahead.
All right. Thank you for the introduction. And before we get started, I just want to mention that one contribution I've made so far is that I have a son who's a San Francisco firefighter, and he's been deployed to fight the wildfires over the last couple of years and expects to go up early this year as the fires are starting. So thank you very much to CARA. We are fellow travelers in a way and have worked out a series of presentations around empowering elders. So this is one of them. And this one will provide some tips today, but we're also going to add a few things about additional ideas for people who are living with vision or hearing loss. And now I have to remember how to change the slides. Ha. There we go. All right. So as I mentioned, it's to do a few tips and also to review a little bit of the handout that you were sent out in advance. Planning ahead, as everybody knows, is the key to staying safe and getting help. So we'll walk through these tips quickly and know that I'm going to ask a question of everybody at the end. So maybe this goes without saying, expect the unexpected. Disasters come in many forms. Let's figure out which one maybe doesn't come to California, but there's fire and smoke, there's floods, there's power outages. I don't know that we have tornadoes yet, but we do have hazardous material spills, hopefully not any more terrorist acts, hurricanes, landslides, tsunami, and of course the big one is earthquakes. So most all of these will happen in California and will impact different areas in different ways. So we hope to touch on some tips that will help everybody no matter where you live. So the four basic steps of being prepared and keeping yourself safe are: plan ahead for your own security and safety. Then do what you need to do to stay safe and connected. Plan your escape route and complete the vial of life form, which hopefully most of you know about, but we'll explain again what that is. So step one, plan ahead for your own security and safety. And that really starts with having an emergency preparedness or go bag or disaster kit. The idea is really to have 3 days worth of supplies per person to get you through 72 hours, because that may be how long you have to wait until you get help. Or you are someplace where other services will be available. So of course that includes water, at least 1 gallon per day. And you should sort of freshen it up every few months, non-perishable protein, daily essentials. So again, if you use a cane or glasses, make sure you have an extra one in there, sunglasses, keys, phone charger, batteries for devices, your healthcare card, medication, whatever you take on a regular basis. And cash, small denominations is best. So those are some of the many things that should be in this go bag. And you can probably imagine other things that might be useful. We do a program locally, and the person who was running it made people come in with all of their things in the bag, including a change of underwear. So just think about what you're gonna need if you're gonna be out there for a while. So the second thing here is to stay safe and connected. So building a buddy system, knowing that you have somebody who will check on you and who you can check on. Know that there's somebody out of the area that you can contact, so that if the systems aren't, communications aren't working as well, and you want people to know that you're safe, be sure to find a way to get that information out to somebody who can spread the word. Know where you're going to meet people if an emergency happens, near your house or in a community center. Again, having a solar powered or battery powered radio or amplification device if you have hearing issues is important in that go bag. Know who to call and where to go. And also know that there is an emergency alert system. I noticed I spelled emergency wrong, but you get the idea. So that in every county, there is a special kind of way that they will set up so they can contact you in an emergency. Next thing is plan your escape route. Now, know the emergency exits in your home at work. Plan how to get downstairs or ramps if you have some accessibility issues. Practice emergency drills, especially if you need assistance getting out. And now we know that this picture isn't just, and what we need to do isn't just looking at our house. Now we need to really look at our neighborhood and figure out if there was a fire or another emergency, how would we safely get out of the neighborhood? How would we be prepared to get out soon enough so that we're not trapped? Fourth one is to complete the vial of life. Again, I hope most folks have done this. It's been on the community living campaign and CARA agenda for a while, because it if you fill it out, it is a handy way to have vital information available for first responders, lists emergency contacts, medications, and allergies, and can be something that you can update regularly. You don't need a doctor sign or anybody else to help you. You just kind of fill out the form, which looks like this, and basically is one place to put the basic information. You know, we in our house, we have one for my house for myself and one for my husband on the refrigerator. We also have copies in my purse and in the car, just in case. So that information is available to us or to anybody who might be trying to help us. And as I mentioned, this can go ideally in a little Ziploc bag, be on your refrigerator with a sticker, and that sticker can be placed somewhere where a first responder, if they're coming to your house, would be able to see it and know that there's some information like, are you on blood thinners, or do you have allergies, or who should they contact? The other thing that is in this presentation, and which you should have received a copy of, is that we put together a 4-page little handout that kind of covers some of these tips. And I'm just going to mention the ones that really specifically might relate to people with a disability. So if you have a hearing impairment, be sure to have replacement hearing aid batteries and a pencil and paper so that if you have to communicate in an emergency. Vision impaired, be sure to label your supplies and keep a can by cane, not a can, cane by your bedside. And if you use a wheelchair, have a patch kit for tires. And if it's if you have a non-powered chair, that's probably good to have handy. And if you need a power chain chair, to have an extra battery should you need it. Some people have support animals, other people have animals that they love, and really to be thinking about how you are prepared to have that animal evacuate with you. The other part of this, and this is in provided in more detail in the handout, is to really think about the evacuation plan that you have in a disaster. Again, you know, if you're traveling in a wheelchair, really important to sort of think through what it's going to take to get you out and safe. And some people suggest that it's important to put a whistle in that go bag so that you can let people know if it's a smoky area or there's something else that makes visibility tough, that a whistle can alert people to where you are. And then there's earthquakes. So, you know, we kind of know we should move away from the windows. You want to protect your head and neck. If you can't crawl under something, you just need to grab a pillow and sort of protect yourself that way. And of course, you'll have your vial of life handy. So that will be good if somebody comes to kind of help you out. So, you know, the other thing that's on this handout are some additional tips and resources related to power outages, fire safety, other places you can go for preparedness information. So those are all listed, and it's kind of a statewide focus. And the last thing is really to make a promise to yourself that you won't put this off, that you'll be taking steps this weekend to get ready. So I don't know, if I could see everybody's hands, and we don't need to do this necessarily, I'd like to know how many people have already done some of these things and feel like you're kind of good to go. Because if you haven't, I really would encourage you to use the next few days to put together that go bag and really think about the things you need to do in an emergency. It is, as we said before, planning ahead is the key to staying safe and to be able to get help. So those next steps start now. And
Marie, Susan Meyer here, staffed with CARA, and I can assist you with the raising of the hands. We have a hand up, Ellen Schwartz.
Okay, and so I will, why don't we just take down this little screen and we can answer questions. Ellen.
I'm looking through my emails for anything with an attachment with this info on it. And I'm finding emails with no attachments with the how to join the Zoom thing. And also I looked on the CARA site, only on my phone is a little hard to navigate. But okay. Where can I find it?
It was sent in one of the emails, but just in case, after today, we're going to be putting all of the recording of this this program on our website. You go to issues and then 2021 forums. And additionally, that pretty flyer you saw will also be there for you to download.
Okay, other questions or tips? You know, this is kind of a quick run through, and I bet anybody who's experienced one of these disasters would have a tip to share with others. So it would be good to see if you have some advice for the rest
of us.
We have a hand up, Marie Tish Leon. Tish, you could unmute yourself, please.
Yes, hi. I just received a tip from a neighbor of mine on how, I live in Lakeside, so we've already have had some fires. And she actually has a fire hose in her garage, just in case. I guess in places in rural areas, it would be nice to have something like that, because if the fire department doesn't get there fast enough, at least you'll have this like fire hose you could put up to your faucet, you know, outside. And she also had two suitcases, one for her and one for her husband, in the garage as well, ready to go with emergency stuff. So it really makes me want to go out and buy a small suitcase specifically just for that. So I thought it was a great idea to share.
That is a good one. Thank you so much. Also, I see in the chat, another suggestion was to make sure you have at least half a tank of gas to be ready to leave in a hurry if you need to.
Next up, we have Keith Umamoto.
Hi, great presentation. Really appreciate it. I have one comment. And maybe it's you've already had it that I wasn't able to read, but my family has this card with all the important relatives and emergency contact that everyone has. Mm-hmm. That we found it really helpful because if any of us got hurt, which actually happened with my uncle, we were able to use it and have a phone tree immediately and available.
That's great.
Second is a question. Based upon the issue of confidentiality, seems like a lot of that information is confidential information that, yeah, you want an emergency person to see, but how do you make sure that the wrong person, say someone broke into your house, doesn't get that, or broke into your car and it's in your car, get that information?
Sure, always a concern. I guess I'd have to say if someone broke into your house or car, this would not be a priority for them. It doesn't really have much information like credit card or social security that would help them. They're gonna be going for things that have a value that they could sell. But you know, this, if you're posting it in your house or putting it someplace like your wallet, it's pretty safe, I think, in general. And the alternative is to have somebody show up and want to provide aid to you and really not know how best to do that based on whatever is happening in the moment and what kinds of medications and other allergies you might have. I like the fact that, you know, there's somebody thinking about two bags or two suitcases to be able to go. And I would just invite people who have already kind of got organized and are ready to do this to think of somebody in your life and be their buddy so that you can take a little time to help them get their act together in the same way that you have. I see another hand, Linda.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to say many years ago, I attended, the firefighters came to my kid's school and they gave us some tips. And one that I will never forget is that they said, if there is no water, you know, for a few days or whatever, don't flush the toilet. You can use trash cans and put them in the toilet and then throw it away. So that way, you know, you have a clean restroom and water in the tank in case of emergency. Thanks. Great.
Thank you. All right, any other questions? All right, I have one maybe you could cover at the end for, you know, I think there's a question, if you have a hose and you're ready to help fight the fire, at what point do you decide that's not a good idea and it's better to leave? But you can answer that later.
Okay, well, thanks so much, Marie, for your helpful tips. I'm reminded to update my vial of life and go check on the go bags, make sure everything is in order. And also, I just want to, one other thing, everyone should get on whatever local or county emergency preparedness network there is, because we always get phone calls, a few, especially in the summer and during the fire season, warning us about what's going to happen. So that's another thing that people should probably do. Okay, our next speaker is Christina Mills from the California Foundation for Independent Living Centers. She's the executive director of that foundation and has been since 2017. She has over 20 years of disability rights and independent living center experiences. She was a member of the California Stakeholder Advisory Committee, and this year launched the Disability Disaster Access and Resources Program that provides people with disabilities before, during, and after a public safety power shutoff. She's a strong advocate for people with disabilities and will share with us some of the advocacy opportunities to provide improved emergency response and service to people with disabilities and older adults. So Christina, go ahead.
Thank you, Tom, and thank you, Jody. Very excited and honored to be here presenting today with Marie, who shared some incredible tips, and Bob and Mike, who it's always great to hear from people who have really been on the ground fighting the fires. I know we don't have a lot of time today, and I really appreciate you guys coming together and having 77 participants on a Friday afternoon. That's great. One of the things I want to add to Marie's discussion is the difference between what a go bag is and an emergency kit. Some of us might not be in a position to leave in a disaster. And in those cases, what might we need to have in our home to remain safe rather than in our go bag? And in addition to that, thinking about some of the personalized things that we may need as people who are older adults and people with disabilities in our go bag. One of the things that I'm always often sharing is, one, I take medication on a regular basis. So having some extra, my physician, like many, won't give me a ton of extra, but at least having a little bit that I've been able to hold over for a week's worth in my go bag. And then secondly, I have asthma, so making sure I have an extra inhaler in there. And then third, and probably maybe most important for me, is having extra batteries for my hearing aids. That one is one that people often forget. And for any of us who have hearing impairments, we know how important it is for us to have operational hearing aids. The other thing though that I wanna point out is because of transportation, because of rural communities, and 25% of Californians live in areas that weren't intended to be built in or built on as residential. And so that's 25% of California's population that is quite literally living in what has historically been known as wildfire threat areas, high fire threat areas. And oftentimes we think about that just being in some of the rural communities that we know of now. But in addition to that, there are areas of Alameda County, there are areas that have been so built over the years that we don't even any longer think about them as being rural communities. But it's important to think about where we buy our homes. And I think that the other piece of that that really gets me is oftentimes those of us retiring or that need affordable homes are moving to rural communities because it's more affordable. And yet we're not necessarily thinking about, because of course we're thinking about a roof over our head, how living here might also expose us to some of the natural disasters that come into play in California. So last year in the spring, we had started our Disability Disaster Access and Resource Program. And it was intended because over the last decade or so, our organization has really been advocating to ensure that people with disabilities and older adults are thought about when it comes to planning and preparing and recovering. Recovering is a big thing that people often forget about from disasters and emergencies. And we had started a coalition that has folks from across the country now joining called the California Disaster Strategies Coalition. And you're all welcome to join. We meet twice a month. The first meeting of the month is usually a speaker on a hot topic or current event. And then our second session of the month is usually driven by some sort of strategy related to advocacy that we're working on. And it's open for all. So I'll make sure I put that information in the chat on how to sign up. Jody invited me to talk more about the advocacy pieces of disaster and emergency readiness. And I could definitely talk about our program as well. And unfortunately, I missed an earlier presentation this year where she did invite me. But one thing I do want to point out is for the, we are doing an incredible amount of work on what Jody called the power shutoffs, what the investor-owned utilities refer to as public safety power shutoffs. But we all know them as just my damn lights went out and I'm pissed. So regardless of what kind of reason our power is going out, it's not helpful. And sometimes, a lot of times, it puts us in unsafe situations. So we've really been focused on that over the last couple of years, but we do a variety of advocacy around all disaster and emergencies. But public safety power shutoffs and the power going out has been our priority. And it's because of the climate change and the natural disasters that are happening now, but are yet to come as well. And I think it's important for us to not let go of, we're still living in a pandemic, and we've learned a lot throughout COVID-19 that may help us, that will help us for future emergencies and disasters. And the way that we have communicated, the creative ways that we've learned to work with each other, to engage when we can't necessarily get together in person, taking some of what was a really horrible year and a half, almost 2 years, and thinking about what were the benefits and the things that we really gained from the pandemic that will help us in disasters and emergencies in the future. There's advocacy to be done at like every level possible when it comes to disaster and emergency preparedness. And I'm gonna start at the local level and then work my way up. But one of the things that I think is really important to mention is CFILC, our organization, does not believe that registries are a way to protect humans and protect life. So a lot of cities and counties will offer a registry so that if you are a person maybe who doesn't have your own transportation or needs assistance of some sort during an emergency or disaster, that you put your name and contact info on this list, and magically somebody's going to appear in a disaster and emergency and help me as a wheelchair user get out of my house. That would be amazing, but I've been in those situations, and guess what? They don't show up. It's a 50-50 chance. So given those situations and how many times we see over and over again, who dies in emergencies, who dies in the wildfires? Older adults and people with disabilities. And you know, policy and politically, there's a term that they give us. They call our population people with access and functional needs. So we all fit under this umbrella of what the government calls access and functional needs. And we work very closely with the California Office of Emergency Services. And some of our early advocacy started with the Governor's Office of Emergency Services establishing an access and functional need director who could essentially have personal lived experience and know what it was going to be like for those of us that unfortunately have to deal with an emergency or disaster. So that advocacy, that was successful about a decade ago, but there's so much more happening. And because of the wildfires over the last few years, and I'll just mention that already California this year, it's because it's become a norm in California, unfortunately, you don't hear as much about wildfires on the news this year as we previously have heard. But according to Cal OES and Cal Fire, there have already been more fires this year than there were last year at this time. That's important to know. So we're not catching it as much as we used to on the typical media channels, but one of my tips and suggestions today is if you are on social media, and I'm assuming many of you have access to Wi-Fi because you're here today, tracking your cities on social media, especially on Twitter, tracking Cal OES, tracking Cal Fire, and all of the CAL FIRES also have specific Twitter pages and Facebook pages for counties as well. That information these days is often far more current and available versus what the news is presenting on what's happening. And I did see a couple folks putting in the chat some of the current fires, like the Big Sur fire that's currently happening. There's also a fire in Southern California that's been going as well. So, there are city and county and state level plans on disasters and emergencies. And guess what? A lot of those plans don't include people with access and functional needs. So the first thing in terms of advocacy is I would look at my city's plan, my emergency and disaster plan, and see how are my community members incorporated into this plan? Are there adjustments or things that need to be done to make it more inclusive and accessible for us? And something, I live in the city of Benicia in the Bay Area, and my city recently put out a quick tip sheet that I'm supposed to put on my window as a reminder of what to do and what my evacuation routes are in a disaster. And that's great for people who can see, but they didn't provide it in large print. I'm not sure that my grandmother could read it. And they didn't offer another way to get that material so that everybody in my community could benefit from knowing where the evacuation route would be for them. So city level advocacy is a much of a need. And also for cities that are not engaging in the conversation, it's never too early. Asking that question during public comments, where is our city in developing our evacuation plans? And where is our city in terms of making sure that we're safe and have some plans in place so that when emergencies or disasters occur, we have a way of maintaining the safety of residents in our city. In addition to that, I want to bring up that there's a lot of those plans that don't get used when the actual disaster or emergency hits. And so also we advocate strongly that we have quick and easy like checklists. If we're in an emergency or disaster, nobody's gonna look at a 100-page plan on what did we say we were gonna do for this or that, or when we opened a shelter that we need to make sure we have refrigerators for people who need refrigerated medication. We need checklists. And how can we offer the city and the fire department and everybody else these checklists to make sure that they're incorporating our needs and our community's needs when there's a disaster or emergency? And some cities have done this. There are appendixes in their plans. And Marin County is one of the counties that, because we did take some legal action in Marin County as an organization, Marin County does have some appendixes that would serve as good examples of what could be in a checklist that might be helpful. In addition, the Board of Supervisors, same sort of thing. How is the Board of Supervisors organizing with the cities? And what accountability is the county taking? One of the things we constantly see that I hope you all now pay attention to is when there's a wildfire or an emergency or disaster in California, it's gotten better over the years, but I'm originally from San Diego. And in 2005, when we had the devastating fires down there, we had an entire community of people who were deaf pass away because live television does not include captioning or American Sign Language. They had no idea what was going on or how close it was to their homes. That's a problem. So when it comes to media efforts, how are we ensuring that our plans also create access? CARA has captioning going on their Zoom right now. And I've noticed during the pandemic, that's been one of the gains, accessibility and making sure that people can access it in writing or through verbal communication or American Sign Language. Let's not lose those access benefits and let's push it further. When the media comes on, when the Board of Supervisor comes on and talks about where the fire is and what the count is and where the shelters are, are we holding the counties accountable to make sure that their shelters are accessible, that their shelters have accessible cots, that caregivers are permitted and that they have a plan on how to get emergency caregivers if they don't have that already? Who are the local organizations that work with folks with access and functional needs to make sure that they're a part of the process, both on site during the disaster, as well as before and in the recovery options? And then also making sure that they know that it's important to communicate and always possible. So if they're giving information out, making sure it's in large print so that everyone can read it, that if they're not providing it, giving some way of contact so that we know who to contact if we need it in some other type of format. In addition to that, the California Public Utilities Commission. So I mentioned earlier that we work a lot on the electricity shutoffs.
We have 1 minute so that we have some time for Q&A.
Thank you. Yes. So one of the things that is really important is folks are asking us constantly, when are the power shutoffs going to end? And there's no answer for that. There's really no answer for that. Climate change is here, and it is one of the ways that the state and the CPUC and the electric companies have chosen to use to try to decrease fires. And while we don't think it's safe for people with disabilities or older adults to not have access to electricity for hours and days on end, the fact is we are also up against people who have lost their lives and homes in the fire. And so while we're advocating for safety and less power shutoffs, the people who have lost family members and homes are advocating for more power shutoffs to have more preventative measures like that in place. And so you all as older adults would qualify for some of those programs, and I will put that in the chat. I'm happy to come back at any time and talk about it at other times, but there's many more other things that we could go over today in regards to power safety shutoffs, as well as just disaster and emergency planning and advocacy. Last but not least, California does have what they call a blueprint for a fire safe California legislative package for 2021. And I will also put that link right now in the chat, but that is specific statewide legislation that CARA may want to look at and track and take a position on. Thank you.
Thanks, Christina. Do we have questions? Susan, are there any questions?
Tom, it looks like Christina did a great job and there's no hands raised. So I think there is one. I'm sorry, there is one. Betsy Kahn. Betsy.
Good afternoon. I am a reporter for our local community radio station in Lake County, California. I cover all aspects of disaster response, relief, recovery, preparedness, mitigation, etc. I wonder if Ms. Mills would be available to be interviewed on a live radio program for our listeners. This was a fabulous presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'll put my contact information in the chat. Thank you so much.
Great.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, Christina, and also Marie and our firefighters for great presentations. We obviously, an hour is not enough time to cover everything, but I think we've got a whole lot of good information, and which we can bring back to our friends and families, and at our local CARA Action Team members, we can talk more about what we can do in terms of advocacy at the local level. And our legislative committee will take a look at the suggestion that Christina had on the firefighting package. Okay, Jody, do you wanna sort of wrap things up here?
Sure. And we'll take a few more questions. I see in a minute, I see David's hand is up. So this was so good, and we could have spent so much more time on this. And I think we will look at how to follow up and do this was the 101 class, and maybe we'll do the 201 class another time. But a lot that we can do, as Marie said, this weekend to make sure we get ready before this all goes out of our head and we start celebrating the 4th of July weekend, which is always kind of a terrifying weekend. I live in San Francisco, and there are official fireworks, but then the whole neighborhood goes up in smoke as people do their own fireworks. So we may not be in the wildfire zone, but there are other challenges here, especially since everything is so dry right now. So please check our website probably on Monday, californiaalliance.org, all spelled out, because the recording of this program will be on it so that you can review it. You can also send it to other people, use it at your own organizational meetings. The flyer that some of you have had trouble downloading, and it's full of color and, you know, may not format exactly right on each person's computer, but we'll have a way for you to download it as a and print it as a PDF, so it'll come out the way you saw it as Marie shared it. Christina is going to put in the chat some of the resources that she alluded to in her presentation, the fire plan and the legislation, her disaster advocacy efforts, and the two monthly meetings that people might want to jump on and learn more about. And just to everybody, our best line of defense is for us to personally make sure we have our vial of life, our to-go bag, stuff in the house that Christina mentioned in case you wind up having to stay there. Connect with people who can help you if you need transportation, if you want to create the buddy system that was talked about. All of these things are things we can do right now to make sure we're as prepared as we possibly can be in the time of a disaster. And stay tuned for our net. We're going to take we've been doing two or three forums a month. We're going to take a little longer break in July and come back on July 30th to celebrate the anniversaries of Medicare and Medicaid, the ADA, Social Security, the Postal Service, and get ready for some congressional lobbying that we're going to be doing during the congressional recess in August, especially as we have this opportunity to win or to get $400 billion or more towards creating a home and community-based service infrastructure. This is a huge opportunity that we do not want to lose. And so we're going to be doing a lot of advocacy over the next month to be ready to take advantage of that. So put July 30th and in your calendar for our next forum. And I think we're going to go, David, I don't see your hand up anymore. So I think we're going to leave you all with a video. And thank you all for being here. Have a happy 4th of July holiday. Thank you, Marie. Thank you, Christina. Thank you, Mike and Bob. And thank all of you for being here. Take care.